God of power and might, your Son shows us the way of service, and in him we inherit the riches of your grace. Give us the wisdom to know what is right and the strength to serve the world that you have made through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our first reading is from Ezekiel 34. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out. As shepherds seek out their flocks when they are among their scattered sheep, so I will seek out my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places to which they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries and will bring them into their own land. And I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, by the watercourses, and in all the inhabited parts of the land. I will feed them with good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel shall be their pasture. There they shall lie down in good grazing land, and they shall feed on rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I will make them lie down, says the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak. But the fat and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them with justice. Therefore, thus says the Lord God to them, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep. because you pushed with flank and shoulder and butted at all the weak animals with your horns until you scattered them far and wide. I will save my flock, and they will no longer be ravaged, and I will judge between sheep and sheep. I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he shall feed them. He shall feed them and be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David shall be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Ephesians. I have heard your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and for this reason I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know that what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet, and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew in the 25th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates sheep from goats. Then he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. And then the king will say to those at the right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' And the king will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me.' Then he will say to those at his left hand, 'You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and all his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick, and in prison, and you did not visit me.' Then they also will answer, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?' Then he will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me.' And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
So as we did last time, I'll have a short little reflection, and then we'll get to our discussion questions. So when we lived in Youngstown, the suburb next door had quite a little debate over two motels. And the name of these motels were the Wagon Wheel and the Boardman Motel. These were not the classiest establishments. To give you an idea of what I'm talking about, the A in Wagon was perennially about to fall off the sign. There were reports of bed bugs, and not a few times somebody from my neighborhood who was homeless would ask me for a ride to one of these two motels because they had gotten the required small of money for a room that night. And that brings us to the debate. The issue was that these not-so-classy establishments were on the main road through this suburb. They were actually at the heart of one of the busiest business intersections in town. They were right in front for everybody to see. Most of the debate involved finding a way to get rid of these two motels. People wanted them shut down. But the key is, they wanted them shut down not because they thought the poor would be better served by other institutions, and not because they thought they were a health risk, but mostly because people thought they were an eyesore. People wanted these motels gone, and because it reminded this relatively well-to-do suburb that there was poverty in their midst. In this respect, this small suburb is not unique. Our perennial response to poverty is to find ways to hide it from sight. The most famous example is when Atlanta hosted the Olympics and they gave everybody who was homeless a one-way bus ticket out of town. There are a ton of other examples. We would prefer simply to bypass or remove the signs of people from poverty in our midst. Our communities find that to be the easiest solution. The problem can seem so massive, simply hiding people becomes the only viable way of coping. How does one community wrestle with the magnitude of homelessness and the opioid crisis and poverty? There are no great answers, no easy solutions, and it's simpler just to close the institutions where those people like to go. Jesus has a different solution to all this in our gospel lesson. Jesus begins at verse 36. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me. And then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. There's a really conventional way of hearing this lesson, and there's a conventional way of reading it. And that conventional way goes like this. Give to the people who are hungry, sick, or in prison, or naked. Give charity to them. And that's a good enough lesson. I hope that you do that. But it's important to hear what Jesus actually says. Jesus says that the hungry, the thirsty, the naked, the stranger, and the imprisoned, they're not random people. They're members of Christ's family, aka they're Christians. Charity is good, but the point of this story is not that you should give to charity, but the point is that those outside the Christian community will be judged on how they treat the naked, the sick, or the suffering. But the catch there is that that means that Christians themselves are supposed to be the ones who are hungry or thirsty or stranger or naked or sick or in prison. What Jesus is implying is that people in poverty are not outsiders. They are a part of us. The people who used those motels are not some strangers apart from us. They should be part of the Christian community. In good Lutheran fashion, the law is this. Do we think that people in poverty or hard situations are separate from us or apart from us? Jesus calls the least of these his brothers. We should too. The gospel, and I know many of you are thinking, where's the good news, Pastor? The gospel is equally simple. I think many people are asking in this time, where is Jesus? The answer in Matthew 25 is really simple. Jesus is easily found. He is with the sick, the naked, the stranger, or in prison. To find him, all we have to do is go there. The Bible rarely offers straightforward answers, and more frequently, God's word actually asks us questions against all the things we're so certain about. In this case, the Bible doesn't tell us what the proper policy toward motels in the suburbs should be, and it doesn't tell us what the proper policy to housing and homelessness is. But Scripture does, however, offer us a question. Are we merely trying to hide people in order to fix the problem of poverty? Or are we really willing to let those people become a part of us in true community? Hiding is our natural human response. Adam and Eve hid in the garden. Jonah tried to hide in the hold of a ship. And to be clear, Jesus doesn't promise that when we welcome the hungry, sick, prison addicted, or those in jail, that our property values will go up. But Jesus does promise new life, that where Jesus is, their resurrection will follow. Welcoming the stranger, the sick, in prison, addicted, thirsty, hungry, and homeless to be a true part of us in honest Christian community might just grant us that freedom and abundant life and resurrection that Jesus so often talks about. So now we get to our question. So in the Gospel of Matthew, one of Jesus's pet names for his disciples is the least of these, right? And that's what he says here, right? As you welcome the least of these. And in verse 40, Jesus calls the least of these members of his family. So he's talking about the least of these are members of the church, right? And so what does it say that Jesus assumes that the members of the church will be sick, hungry, thirsty, stranger, and in prison? And does that change your interpretation of the passage?
Well, I'll start.
Okay.
I think that that all of that acknowledges the human condition.
Okay. Yep.
And when I read this passage, it isn't only, I mean, I think it is the poor as far as lacking money, the sick as far as being physically sick, but I also think that it's a poor in spirit. It's a poor in, it's a sickness in that we, especially for us who live in greater wealth, there is a sickness to us from the standpoint that we often want to hide those who have a more obvious poorness. And that's poor too, as far as I'm concerned. And I also think that this is a very, very strong call to action by Christ. It's telling us once again, which he often does, you can't just sit by the sidelines. You know, my followers are called to take action, to be with those people who are less well off than we are. And so I don't really think it changes my interpretation much. I think it just adds to it.
I had a friend who in seminary, and he always thought that instead of count, you know, we always count how many people come to worship or how many people are watching online. But he actually thought we should count these things. You know, he's like, how many times did we visit somebody who was sick? How many times did we go to somebody in prison? You know, that would be the thing to count if you wanted to count anything. Dave?
So when I look at this, I look at it as we're all children of God.
Oh yeah, right? That's absolutely true.
You know,
yeah.
we got the baptism going on for us. We've got this family. And when you brought this up in the question, yeah, you don't think about the Christians needing that same.
Yeah.
That, I mean, we as Christians don't always agree. We squabble about the stupidest things. All right.
Well, yep.
I think anyway. But we're all children of God, and we have to, you know, just like every time we were driving Julia to Miami, there was someone on the side of the street, which is when I saw that person on the street, I think of this passage.
Yep.
Right? For me. But then I think of what we as a church is, we are nourishing, right? That's part of our vision as resurrection is the nourishing part. And everybody needs the nourishing. It's like the concentric circle. It's, you got the community, you've got the world, you've got even us in the center of us being maybe the Christian concentric circle of we need the nourishment. We need to be whole too.
Yeah.
I like your point, Renee, about, you know, it's not just, you know, the food part, but it's the whole person part that we have to reach.
Yeah.
And our commitment as believers is to treat everyone equally.
Yeah. No, all right. I mean, big question people ask me, what's the biggest difference between being an inner city pastor and in the suburbs? And I say, well, the biggest difference is not that the issues are different, because there's addicts, there's homelessness, there's, you know, people struggling with rent. Those issues are kind of constant. The biggest difference is, kind of like Renee said, people here in Hilliard don't want to admit those things. People were really honest, and it almost made it easier in some ways, you know, because there was no hiding it in the inner city. You know, people were just kind of pretty honest about what they were going through.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
I think that's one of the pluses of working with First English, is that it really opens your eyes, first of all, to what's important.
Yep.
Because for them, it can be very basic.
Yep.
Having a warm place to be on a Sunday morning and have a meal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whereas I might be worrying about my whole week.
Mm-hmm.
For them, it is simply that moment,
right,
is getting their belly filled.
Right.
I don't worry about that.
Yep.
And it's a perspective that is very eye-opening and humbling.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that it really brings us back to what Christ is asking of us. He's asking us to see that, to open our eyes to that, and not try to ignore that it exists.
Yep.
So,
Dan.
Yeah, before we get to me, interesting discussion starting on the chat, and that is Mike Biggert said that he doesn't think that it lets us off the hook with the rest of humanity.
No, yeah, absolutely not,
point.
Right.
And Charlie responded too with, you know, Mike, absolutely not. We are to love and care for all, no exceptions.
Yep. Yeah.
So.
Right. No, absolutely. Right. Doesn't, there's no letting off the hook with Jesus.
And I'm liking seeing how this is resonating. Mike Tomeo says he thinks the message is that we're all human, no matter your wealth status, no matter the other stuff, that we should just love and honor each other. But he asks, how do we know your needs, what you need help with, versus who takes advantage?
Yeah.
That charity.
Yeah, that can be
hard. That's a hard one. This is actually Pastor Sally at First English said this one time. Grace means you're going to get taken advantage of. You know, it just...
So that's a given.
Yeah, like there's no avoiding that. You know, if we are a people of grace, which I think we are as Lutherans, then that means we get taken advantage of.
Yeah.
You know, now you want to be wise because our resources are limited. That's a slightly different issue. But, you know, we're going to get taken advantage of. There's just no way around that. Doesn't mean we try and be foolish with our resources, because they are limited. But we need to acknowledge that that's probably not something we can avoid, right? Because, all right. You know, we're people of grace.
And I think God, that's where we have to have faith that God will step in and bring the message home to maybe that person that takes advantage of us.
Right.
In a way that we couldn't. So.
Right.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting. It reminds me of when I was working in Atlantic City.
Mm-hmm.
One of my coworkers was, I don't know how you phrase it, a deposed millionaire. He had been making it big on Wall Street, and his life kind of came tumbling down.
Mm-hmm.
The catalyst was a divorce that was very nasty, which is why he was then associating with me. As he tumbled down to my low level.
Right.
As he was climbing the ladder, his mentor, who was a mega millionaire, the first time he had him come out to dinner with him, and they had left the restaurant, were walking down one of the streets of New York, and there was a homeless person begging. And he pulled out $20, and the millionaire pulled out $20 and gave it to this guy.
Yeah.
And he asked, my friend asked the same question. How do you know he's not just going to turn around and go buy drugs with it.
Mm-hmm.
He's not really hungry.
Yeah.
How can you afford to do that? And his mentor's response was, how can I afford not to?
Yeah.
And I thought that was, again, gets to that,
mm-hmm.
what you had said. His attitude was, I know that some of these people are going to take advantage of me.
Right.
But I can't afford to let that one person who does truly need it.
Right.
To pass me by.
Yep.
And I thought that was.
Yep. Right. And just the truth is, you don't know, you know, but you never know, you know. And,
yeah.
I am not God.
Yeah.
And it's. Yeah, yeah. One last comment that came through was that sometimes the bigots were saying that sometimes it's about bringing comfort to the afflicted.
Mm-hmm.
And in this case, it's bringing affliction to we the comfortable.
Yep.
It's a nice twist.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. No, I mean, Dave was saying this passage is hard, you know, before we started. And it is hard. I won't mince words about that. This is one of those ones where I always want to say, the gospel of the Lord with a question mark. You know. All right, question two. Jesus says here that that our communities, and I know he says nations, but I kind of think we can think about this as our communities, right? You know, that the larger communities we're a part of are judged based on how we treat the least of these. So think about the larger communities you're a part of. And I guess my simple question is, how do you think they're doing? And how can they and we improve?
When I talked to Mrs. Nelson about all this stuff, mm-hmm. too. So one of the words she used was culture.
Yeah.
Mm. And how culture treats people.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, you look at the different levels, the local level, the national and the global level,
mm-hmm.
and how we do. I think globally you have pockets that really do well
yeah.
at taking care of our people. And locally we... You know, sometimes it's the attempt
yeah.
that matters.
Right.
It's really the attempt and not the result.
Yeah.
Because the result is we'll always have the poor.
Yeah.
We will always have the poor no matter what we do.
Yeah.
And, you know, I look at this, you know, these were the top six, you know, the naked.
Yeah.
But there are other things that aren't in here that we do mm-hmm. to help others. And by doing good, it's purposeful. It's something that's not normal.
Mm-hmm.
And when we do that as a culture, when we do that as a people, as a community, as a church of God, it's important.
Yeah,
I really do. And that purposeful out of the ordinary things really does help us. And it's a blessing to each one of us that do it.
Yeah.
Not just in the end, but even in getting to that end game that Jesus talks about between the sheep and the goats.
Yeah.
It really is.
Yeah. I mean, I've been harping on this a lot lately, but I'll say it again. Like, we as Lutherans believe everything is saint and sinner, right? You know, and what that means is, like, whole communities can be two things at the same time,
yep.
you know? And so, you know, a church can be particularly bad at helping all the people Jesus lists here in one way.
Yep.
But all their Senate dollars, for example, go on to things like Lutheran World Relief, mm-hmm. Lutheran Disaster Relief, yep. you know, like that's where your Senate dollars go, is all these Amparo, the immigrant, you know, Lutheran mm-hmm. Immigration Services, all, you know, all these institutions we have that actually help all these people, you know, and so churches can be both. They can be both a community that struggles with this, and they can be also be giving to institutions that solve these things.
It's kind of a shame that we're a little removed from what happens with that money.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
We have to be reminded
right.
what that money is doing.
Right.
And we might lose sight of that here. And that this past week, I was reading an article that mm-hmm. Lutheran churches are the top sanctuary churches in the country.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So it's Lutherans more than anyone else who are opening their doors
mm-hmm.
to welcome these people who need mm-hmm. some kind of protection.
Yeah.
And Lutheran World Relief is huge as
yeah, it's actually the top disaster.
The top disaster.
The relief organization in the one of them in the planet, you know.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
Lutheran Immigration and Resettlement Services it's us and Catholic Charities that are the two largest resettlement you know, and immigration help agencies in the country. And I know for a while, this, I don't know if this is still true, but I know for a while, like in Michigan, Lutheran Social Services was the single largest private aid agency in the state.
Wow.
You know, it's Graceworks here in Ohio, but it's similarly huge, you know. It's, yeah. And so, right, you know.
The Bakers point out how important it is. They say if poverty were an easy problem to fix, we would have fixed it.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
We had kind of an interesting experience at work. We're working on our diversity, inclusion, and respect training. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that they focused on with us in the exercises that we went through was to distinguish between pity, empathy, or pity, sympathy, empathy, and compassion.
Yeah.
And our exercises were built so that we had to be active listeners. Mm-hmm. So that you could not be, we want to kind of eliminate pity and sympathy from the our understanding of other people. We want to be empathetic. Mm-hmm. And we all, so that we can be compassionate.
Yep.
And those exercises were very eye-opening about how important it is to listen. Mm-hmm. Which we don't give a lot of time for.
Yep.
In our lives. And everybody that went through the exercises found it very, it felt very supportive. Mm-hmm. Of us as a work group.
Yeah.
And I think those things can be helpful in this situation as well. You know, yeah. Looking for how can we listen to the needs. I don't always think that happens in our government processes. And,
no. Yeah.
You know, I think that that's something that we could be much better at. But as individuals, we can do that. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
Kate points out something that should be mm-hmm. much more prominent to us, that Lutheran Social Services runs choices. Mm-hmm. Which, yeah. And this really shocks me in a mm-hmm. city as big as Columbus.
Yeah.
What shocks me is that Choices is the only,
yeah.
only domestic violence shelter in Franklin County.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's shocking, isn't it?
It's
almost
yeah.
insane.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right. It's, right.
But it's
14th largest city in the country and, yeah. you know, and yeah.
And yet
yeah.
one shelter
yeah.
for all that. And it's Lutheran Social Services that does it. We're getting, again, yeah. online, things are going great. Todd mm-hmm. Daniels was saying that in working with the Columbus Crew players, he's learned from them the ways they have suffered in their home countries.
Yeah.
Things that we would never even think about here
right.
in the States. And they want to quietly help out here and in their home countries because they feel it is best to be silent when you lift up people, because mm-hmm. if you shout it in their countries, that can then cause damaging problems
yeah.
for their families.
Right. Yes. There's lots of right ramifications. Yeah. And I think, you know, you said compassion, Renee, and out of all those words, that compassion is actually the biblical value, you know, mm-hmm. is compassion. God has compassion on us and therefore we have compassion on others.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah. And Clem and Judy want to say, or are saying too mm-hmm. that it's often the small things.
Yeah.
That for them, you can't put a price on how much a more card and prayers mm-hmm. mean to people who are in times of challenge.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, I mean, Jesus's list here is actually not all that complicated. It's,
no.
You know, it's actually simple. Like he doesn't say, as you solved poverty,
right.
you know, like, so you helped me. Like he actually doesn't say that, you know, he says as you, or he doesn't say as you liberated people from prison, you know, that is part of the call sometimes, but actually what he said is visit.
Yeah.
you know, that all it is, you know, he didn't say as you made the sick well, he said as you visit the sick. You know, it's actually the simplest things are the hardest, but they're not complicated.
Yeah.
You know, his list here is actually fairly uncomplicated.
I mean, he didn't put prayer shawls.
Yeah,
but,
right.
But think about that. There's yeah. somebody from work that I gave to the husband yeah. who gave it to the wife, and she thanks us for them all the time.
Right.
Yeah.
She has it with her, and it's that mm-hmm. outreach. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're going to see this in bold at the end of December when the money runs out yeah. for all these people.
Yeah.
I mean, we don't, unless you're reading the paper and really are looking at that, mm-hmm. you don't know what's going to happen, and we don't know as a church how much more we're going to have to give to that.
Yeah.
yeah. Right.
But that's what we're here for.
Right.
And yet it can multiply, has a multiplying effect.
Yep. Yeah.
Earlier in the conversation that Todd had pointed out that, I think it was Todd, that someone from who was attending, taking advantage of Bold, mm-hmm. needed the services, who was pregnant, mm-hmm. ended up coming, I think it said, I have to scroll back, but I think he said for Operation Christmas Child.
Yeah.
No, she was
to help out and give back.
Yeah.
Yep.
So it makes a difference. It changes people.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, you're talking about where's the grace in the story.
Right,
but the
right.
grace is actually pretty easy for us. You know, you want to know where Jesus is, come to Bold on Monday nights.
Yeah.
You know, yeah.
There was a novel I read once that had, it was post-apocalyptic, mm-hmm. but this guy goes in search of God through all this tragedy and chaos mm-hmm. and suffering. And he doesn't find him with the survivalists who had everything and are coming out of the apocalypse fine. He finds him in this camp of people who are deformed and the lowest of the low and dirty and sick, mm-hmm. the equivalent of lepers in Jesus' time.
Yeah.
And he sees this stunted little dwarf dancing
mm-hmm.
and he realizes that's God.
Yeah.
And he goes over to him and this has stuck with me for 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
His line is, God is like water. Mm. I love to settle in the lowest places.
Yep. Yeah, amen.
So, and it's a call out from Charlie. He just says, remember that December 1st is Giving Tuesday. So consider Lutheran Social Services and other community agencies who could be blessed by even a small gift.
God bless that. Yes, amen. So final question. So this Sunday is Christ the King Sunday. If you're not a church nerd like me, Christ the King Sunday is the last, this is the end of our year. You know, this is New Year's Eve for us Christians, right? And Advent begins a new church year. So next Sunday is New Year's Day, right? You know, so this Sunday is Christ the King Sunday. Christ the King is the day where we acknowledge that Jesus is the supreme Lord. I said in, and Dave corrected my bad grammar, which is great.
You saw that.
Yeah, I did. In and of the world. Prepositions always bothered me. That Jesus is supreme Lord, right? You know, and so the question then is, what does this passage tell us about Jesus' lordship or Jesus' kingship?
I love this question.
Yeah.
And the reason is because I think when you think of the word lordship or king mm-hmm. or whatever, you think of somebody who exerts a lot of power.
Yeah.
You know, they bring a lot of people respect them just because they are that.
Yeah.
And I felt that this passage really is about Christ being that compassionate leader.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about how tough on crime he is or any of that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It's about him being the example of what we should be and expecting us to be as compassionate in the world as he is toward us. That's what I took from this, which is it's a much more accessible leader.
Yeah.
And I think that's often what the gospel brings over and over and over again, is that Christ and God are with us. They're not up on a high pedestal someplace. They mm-hmm. are with us every day, you know, and it's important to remember that we aren't alone in those efforts that we might need to make to meet what he's asking us to do.
Yeah, no, I agree. Yeah. I mean, there's a painting in my office, if you're ever in my office, and it's Jesus before Pilate, you know, and there's a lot of reasons I really like this painting. But one of the reasons is, you know, Jesus he's just come back from the beating. He's got the crown of thorns on his head, you know, and he's right before Pilate. And boy, is that the contradiction between Pilate, who represents Rome and all earthly authority, you know, in this room at the moment. And you got Jesus, you know, who's also, you know, supreme Lord of the universe, you know, and yet the contradiction could not be, you know, greater in who they are. Just seeing them right next to each other like that always gets me.
If I'm not mistaken, this is the second time you talk about Palm Sunday in the church year. Because this is when this is, and it's talking about Jesus' mm-hmm. triumphant entry.
Yeah, right. This is just right post. Right. Right. This is post. Yeah, like the next chapter, they start the Good Friday sequence. Okay. You know. Okay. So.
And Renee, when you say about approachable, I mean, you see all these people putting all their coats and their palms, and and this is lauding mm-hmm. the man who they have respected. And is a model of who they can be. Mm-hmm. It's not somebody, and yes, you hear this on the reading of being on the throne mm-hmm. and with the angels, but the approachable part means, yeah, there's mercy for you.
Yeah.
Yeah, there is mercy. And the flip side to that is the stern part. He will do the judging.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. That's there too. Mm-hmm. So yeah. As we use and model and give and the mercy that's going to be given to us and the blessings, it's all here in this reading. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it, you know, Lord of Lords, in your glory, but you're also the caretaker.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the great rulers of the world are the ones that take care of his or her people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. John Calvin has a good quote where he says, it is comforting to know that the one who judges you is also the one who died for your sins. Mm-hmm. You know, and there's something to remember about that. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Final thoughts, Dan?
Well, a couple on this one is that what a lot of people don't know, Renee is probably the only one in the room who knows, is that I also do leadership consulting. And part of the certification process and the studying, looking at statistics, compassionate leaders. And this is like a big shocker to most Americans because worldwide, we have the worst leadership compared to other nations, both governmentally and corporately, our businesses. And one of the striking things is that we worship Pilate as our leaders. Mm-hmm. We like the leaders who are not compassionate, understanding at all. But statistically, compassionate leaders get better performance out of the people who follow them.
Right.
So compassionate, like New Zealand. Look at New Zealand's leader.
Yeah.
And how they handled COVID like better than anyone on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
But even in the corporate sector, compassionate leaders get better, end up with better corporate profits, better customer loyalty, better staff loyalty, better institutional knowledge and all that. So even 2,000 years ago, we knew that compassionate leaders are the best, but in 2,000 years, we still haven't learned to live that way.
Yep.
And so that led to me to thinking that this passage really says that love your neighbor, no exceptions, is the law of the land.
Yep.
The twist is you don't get your judgment about whether or not you violated that law until the end.
Yeah, no, right. There is a kind of, right. And on both sides of that, right? Whether you lived into it or whether you
lived out of it. Yeah,
you lived out of it. That's why we believe in grace. You know, in the end, you got to trust that, right.
Yeah.
You got to trust.
And I don't know who this is. It just says DRS, so maybe you guys know. But doctors, okay. It strikes them so hard. I'm glad you had that, Charlie.
That's a clever, good job, Doc.
We're going to turn this into a game, I think. But anyway, it strikes them as so hard how our king, for so many years, we have never seen or touched you know, in two millennia, and yet still rules our thoughts and hearts.
Yep. Yeah, no, that's absolutely true. And also, yet in a certain way, when we have communion, right, you know, you do touch him, right?
Yeah.
And if you come to Bold, you know, or if you help out at First English or at Choices, you know, that's part of the meaning of this, you know, of this passage is like, we do get to, but not in the way that, the apostles did, but, and not in the way we will in his fullness when he comes again, you know, but in a certain way, we do get to, you know, but it's very different than what we would expect.
Yeah. And Charlie points out that the Lord of all who could demand everything from us, be a total despot and, you know, tyrannical leader, wants us to help others.
Yep. Absolutely.
That's his message. One interesting metaphoric thing here that, that really jumped out at me only now in this reading and with the discussion is the metaphor of sheep versus goats.
Yeah.
And I think that, think about that for a moment. Of the two, which is the most more productive, more valuable to material humanity? It's the goat.
Yeah.
The sheep, it's just kind of wimpy. Yeah. You get wool once or twice a year from it. La-di-da.
Right.
And for all that effort, so much trouble to steer the flock, to protect it.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas goats, they can protect themselves.
Right.
You know, they can be aggressive. They can eat anything, so they're low maintenance. Highly productive. You know, you can get cloth from them if you want, but you can also get goat's milk.
Mm-hmm.
We eat goat.
Right.
And yet, in this, it's the goats who are seen as negative and the sheep as positive.
Yep. Yeah, it's a part of what Jesus does. He flips our sense of value.
It totally flips it. And the bigots right on that theme with sometimes it looks like the bad is winning.
Mm-hmm.
And so perhaps the lordship of Jesus is about playing the long game.
Yep, I would agree with that. Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you, everybody. So we're moving on to the blessing of prayer shawls. So I'm going to go down here, down front. You can see we have a lot of prayer shawls that need blessing. Friends in Christ, today we give thanks to God and we seek God's blessing as we gather to bless these prayer shawls to the praise and glory of God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O Lord God, ruler of the universe. You made the whole earth for your glory. All creation praises you. We lift up our voices to join the songs of heaven and earth, of things seen and unseen. You stretched out the heavens like a tent. You divided the day from the night. You appointed times and seasons for work and rest, for tearing down and for building up. You blessed your people through all generations and guided them in life and in death. Abraham and Sarah, Moses and Miriam, Isaiah and all the prophets, Mary, mother of our Lord, Peter, James, John, and all the apostles, and all the saints in your church of ages past, in whom your spirit spoke and moved. We give you thanks, O God, for those who labored on these prayer shawls, and we ask you to bless the fruits of their work. Grant us faith to know your gracious purpose in all things, and to continue your blessings to us through the bounty of your creation. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Since it's a white Sunday, we confess the Nicene Creed. So with the whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. With the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
Longing for Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all those in need. Sovereign of all, train our ears to hear your cry in the needs of those around us. Bless all social ministries of the church through which we seek to serve others as we ourselves have been served. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. You cause rain to fall on the just and unjust alike. Direct our use of creation to provide for the needs of all people in ways that are sustainable for the earth. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. Bring peace to every place where conflict rages. Grant opportunities for ending divisions among us and usher in your reign of unity and reconciliation. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Heal the sinful divisions we erect between us and release us from the systems of oppression and prejudice. Restore our capacity to see your image in those whose dignity we have stripped away. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. Pour out the gifts of your Spirit on children and youth throughout the church. Sustain those who work in children's ministry, youth ministry, and campus ministry as they nurture the gifts of young people. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Thank you for saints now departed who fed the hungry, clothed the naked, and tended to the sick. Inspire us by their example that we may see your presence in those in need around us. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. Receive our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Save. His glories now we sing. not fail throughout eternity.
We continue with the thanksgiving for the word. O God of justice and love, we give thanks to you that you illumine our way through life with the words of your Son. Give us the light we need. Awaken us to the needs of others. And at the end, bring all the world to your feast. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now is the acceptable time, and now is the day of salvation. May the Holy God, speaking, spoken, and inspiring, bless you and unbind you and send you in love and in peace. Amen. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.